seated. So, this is the day of the year when it's traditional to renew our baptismal vows together. And we're going to do that in a moment. And it takes the place of our confession, and it contains within it our creed, our declaration of faith. And it draws together all sorts of themes. It reminds us of what it meant for us to make these vows or for them to be made on our behalf when we were baptized. Calls us back to what it means to be baptized people. And I think empowers us to live like that. It tells us what it is that God promises to equip us with, as well as what we've promised to be. So, if you've been baptized before, this is a wonderful moment of renewal. If you haven't been baptized before, then these are the promises that members of the church make, the things that bind us together. And if these are things that are true of you, feel free to join in. But it might be that this is a prompt to seek baptism, to later in the year, to see whether this might be the thing for you. And if you feel that you've been away from your faith, that things have not been going as you wish they had been, this is a moment to say to God, I commit again to those things that I have formerly committed to. So, as we begin, Joe's going to light our Paschal candle, the sign of Jesus' light in the world, the candle that we first lit at Easter. And some words are going to appear on the screen, and if they're true for you, we'll say them together. In baptism, God calls us out of darkness into his marvelous light. To follow Christ means dying to sin and rising to new life with him. Therefore, I ask, do you reject the devil and all rebellion against God? I reject them. Do you renounce deceit and the corruption of evil? I renounce them. Do you repent of the sins that separate us from God and neighbor? I repent of them. Do you turn to Christ as Savior? I turn to Christ. Do you submit to Christ as Lord? I submit to Christ. May God, who has given you the desire to follow Christ, give you strength to continue in the way. Brothers and sisters, I ask you to profess the faith of the church. Do you believe and trust in God the Father? I believe in God, the Father Almighty, creator of heaven and earth. Do you believe and trust in his Son, Jesus Christ? I believe in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended to the dead. On the third day he rose again. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of the Father, and he will come to judge the living and the dead. Do you believe and trust in the Holy Spirit? I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. Almighty God, we give you thanks for our fellowship in the household of faith with all who have been baptized into your name. Keep us faithful to our baptism and make us ready for that day when the whole creation shall be made perfect in your Son, our Saviour, Jesus Christ. Amen. May Christ dwell in your hearts through faith, that you may be rooted and grounded in love and bring forth the fruit of the Spirit. Amen. I don't know about you, I find that an incredibly moving thing to do. This is the last time I did renewing of baptismal vows was just before my ordination. It's good to keep recommitting to God, you know. Every time you step into a new thing, and I suppose that's probably why this comes at this part of the year. It's a new year still, and we recommit to God. In so doing, we also commit to one another. And so, we have some news from our community together. This afternoon, it probably will be this morning, immediately after church, sort of 5-10 minutes after the service finishes, there will be a welcome team meeting over the tables by the coat hooks. If you are involved in the welcome team, if you'd like to be involved in the welcome team, or if you just wonder what that involves, then please do come along and join in. Claire will be leading that meeting. I'm so excited by what we're doing with the welcome team and the fact that we're trying to continue to always be better at welcoming people in. I think we're really good at welcoming people in, but the fact that we're working on it makes me so joyful. This evening, prayer and worship evening is to be held at the Kingfisher Church in Barton, I think, isn't it? Barton? Yes. This evening, between 6:30 and 8 o'clock. It's a prayer evening for the whole city. I think it's going to be a really powerful time of joining together with our brothers and sisters across the city. They have asked that people who attend wear a mask and, if possible, do a lateral flow test before turning up. They're doing a good job, I think, of being aware of the fact that joining many communities together could be a risk, so they're keeping it as safe as possible. Next week, at 7 p.m. on Saturday on Zoom, we're having a beetle drive. Woo! Yes, some excitement for my wife, if no one else. It's not that I paid her or anything, but yes, I'm excited about this. I am leading an online beetle drive. Do you know what an online beetle drive looks like? Neither do I. Come along and find out. There'll be a prize. It'll either work or it won't, but it probably would be more fun if it doesn't. So there's a promise. And that's in the slot where we've normally had the quiz, and I for some reason said, let's do a beetle drive, so we'll find out how that goes. And then one last piece of news. We heard last week that Joe has accepted the bishop's invitation to become the area dean, which is a wonderful thing. Please keep praying for Joe, but particularly on Thursday at 7:30. The chapter, all of the vicars from the city will be gathering here, and the Archdeacon Hillary will be joining us to commission Joe for that role. So please continue to pray. At this point, our children are going to leave us. And anyone who doesn't feel that a sermon best suits them in terms of exploring the Bible, and Howard's going to be out in the foyer, feel free to go and join with her in exploring the readings. But we're going to have our first reading, please.
The first reading is from Acts chapter 8, verses 14 to 17. When the apostles in Jerusalem heard that Samaria had accepted the word of God, they sent Peter and John to Samaria. When they arrived, they prayed for the new believers there that they might receive the Holy Spirit, because the Holy Spirit had not yet come on any of them. They had simply been baptized in the name of the Lord Jesus. When Peter and John placed their hands on them, and they received the Holy Spirit. This is the word of the Lord.
Please sit or stand to respond to words about Jesus. Hear the gospel of our Lord Jesus Christ according to Luke. Glory to you, O Lord. The gospel reading is taken from Luke chapter 3, starting at verse 15. The people were waiting expectantly and were all wondering in their hearts if John might possibly be the Messiah. John answered them all, "I baptize you with water, but one who is more powerful than I will come, the straps of whose sandals I am not worthy to untie. He will baptize you with the Holy Spirit and fire. His winnowing fork is in his hand to clear his threshing floor and to gather the wheat into his barn, but he will burn up the chaff with unquenchable fire." And with many other words, John exhorted the people and proclaimed the good news to them. But when John rebuked Herod the Tetrarch because of his marriage to Herodias, his brother's wife, and all the other evil things he had done, Herod added this to them all: he locked John up in prison. When all the people were being baptized, Jesus was baptized too. And as he was praying, heaven was opened, and the Holy Spirit descended on him in bodily form like a dove. And a voice came from heaven, "You are my son whom I love. With you I am well pleased." This is the gospel of the Lord. And I would just like to pray for Jo now, as like John, she exhorts us and proclaims the good news to us. Lord, be with Jo now and let the words that you want her to say be the ones that come to her mind to say, and the words that you want us to hear and absorb, may they be the ones you want us to absorb. In Jesus' name, amen.
Thank you, Jane. Good morning, everyone. Let me add my welcome to that of Luke's. For those of you who don't know me, I'm Jo Pestle, and I'm the vicar here. It's lovely to see you all this morning. I can't physically see you guys at home, but hello as well. So I wonder if any of you have had an epiphany, a sudden revelation of something, when things that were mysterious feel like they suddenly make sense. Well, over this week, in this 40-day period of Christmas, we've sort of shifted our focus into Epiphany, beginning with the arrival of the Magi and the revelation of who Jesus really is to the Gentiles, to those who didn't follow the Jewish faith. Our brothers and sisters in the Eastern Church call this time of the church year Theophany rather than Epiphany, because it's the time when God in Jesus Christ is revealed, first to those who were wise enough to seek God beyond their own understanding or expectation, and then today, as we remember the baptism of Jesus Christ, we're thinking about the revealing of God as Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, as we see Jesus being baptized and the voice of God the Father saying, "This is my beloved Son." And God the Holy Spirit comes down and rests upon him. Next week, Jesus will be revealed in playful power as he begins his public ministry by turning water into wine. But today, our focus is on God, the Holy Spirit. And my prayer for us is that we will have an epiphany, a divine revelation of who God is, particularly God, the Holy Spirit. Now, I wonder how you feel about God, the Holy Spirit, and baptism in the Holy Spirit. I know when I became a Christian in the charismatic community church, I felt quite afraid of the idea of the Holy Spirit and felt that experiencing the Holy Spirit would be something where I would be out of control. In part, this was because I heard people speaking in tongues and having words of knowledge, maybe falling over in the Spirit when they were prayed for. It felt scary because I'd never seen or heard those things before. But I was also intrigued, I think, because I knew in my heart that if God really was God, then there would be experiences that felt mysterious and unexplainable, that were beyond the human and that were touching the divine. Also, I thought that if God really was the God I thought I was discovering, then ultimately those experiences of the Holy Spirit would be characterized by love and by peace and a greater revelation of who God is. Sadly, I think as a church, we can often make baptism in the Spirit some sort of marker of being a proper Christian, or a holy hierarchy of gifts that can lead to a competitive spiritual one-upmanship, rather than joining us together as the wonderful, diverse family of God that I think is the true marker of the work of the Holy Spirit. So before we plunge in deeper, I just wondered if we might do a quick recap on names of the Holy Spirit that we have in the Bible. Who can share some names or characteristics of who the Holy Spirit is? Please feel free to shout them out, and I might possibly be able to see things on chat as well if they come from home. Wisdom. Ooh, I like that. Great start. Comforter. Advocate. Friend. Yes, I like that. Breath. Yes. Ooh, you're doing well on my list. Truth. Brilliant. Paraclete. So very literally, para is sort of alongside and cleat, or is a shortened version of to call, so the one who calls and encourages us from alongside. Any more? Love? Great, I like that. Just inspirer? Very good. Here's a hint. The Spirit intercedes for us, prays for us. Indweller? I like that. Grace coming in from the chat. How many more have I got? Fruit grower, I thought. Gift giver. Fire. Nice. One final one. We don't usually say this very often, but the Bible talks about the Holy Spirit being a seal or a deposit, confirming our salvation. Oh, I think we've done well there. That looks pretty much my whole list. We didn't get one, actually. Convictor of sin. This is very important, I think, as well. I don't know about you, but when I think about all of those names of who the Holy Spirit is, I think, yes, I really want to be open to that experience of God in my life. So let's press on. In both of our readings today, we see a separation between baptism in water and baptism in the Holy Spirit. But I don't see these more broadly in the Bible as being sequential things, more that they show different things are going on. One, our baptism in water is an act of our obedience, a public confession, if you like, much like we've done this morning, where we say we want to die to ourselves, repent and turn away from sin, and live as God followers, or live in connections with Jesus, as we've begun to say. So we reminded ourselves of that commitment of baptism in water this morning by renewing our baptism vows. The other, baptism in the Holy Spirit, is an act of God's grace towards us, which we can receive. In our Acts reading, when it says the Holy Spirit had not yet come upon them, in some translations it says, not yet have fallen on them. And there's the sense in this of an embrace. In the story of the prodigal son, as the son turns back towards the father, and the father runs towards him and embraces him, it's the same word. The same word that we have in Acts, of the Spirit coming or falling upon or embracing us. There's a sense of coming together. It's a place of healing and of wholeness, of revelation of who you really are. In Romans 8, Paul puts it like this: you did not receive a spirit that makes you a slave again to fear, but you received a spirit of sonship. And by him we say, Abba, Father. The Spirit himself testifies with our spirit that we are God's children. Jesus is the one who restores humanity to our original purpose and makes it possible for us to take part in that. And we are witnesses in the reading from Luke of this most intimate moment between Jesus and his Father. As Jesus is baptized, we get an insight into his prayer life as he stands there and prays and talks to his Father, and we hear the voice of the Father to the Son, saying, my Son, my beloved. And the Holy Spirit comes and testifies that that is true. And that relationship of parent and child is also possible for us to have with God. We are God's children. And I think the most important experience of the baptism of the Holy Spirit is hearing God saying that to you, my son, my daughter, my beloved. This is where our freedom begins, knowing that we are loved by God. But we must also say that there's something wild and holy in this love. John says to his followers that Jesus will come, the powerful Messiah who will baptize with the Holy Spirit and fire. And there is a judgment in this, a separation of the wheat from the chaff, of the goodness in our lives from the things that lead us away from God. The wind and the fire and the cloud are signs in Scripture of God's presence. In our Old Testament, leading people out of slavery into freedom, into a covenant relationship that's ultimately written on our hearts as the Spirit is poured out on all people. And we become our true selves, truly the image of God, as we turn away from the sins that enslave us and we allow God to break those chains and set us free, so that God can be revealed through and in us. We cannot do this life, this Christian life, without God, the Holy Spirit. So how do we receive the Holy Spirit? Jesus, and then John and Peter in our Acts reading, showed us that we pray. We pray with open hearts, and a desire to receive God in this way. It's to turn into the loving embrace of our Father. And our readings today don't tell us much of what that experience looks like. Simply that as they prayed, they received the Holy Spirit. My experience is that this most often is characterized by a deep peace or a sense of being loved by God. But sometimes it does feel like fire. Sometimes you will speak in other languages or experience God giving you other gifts. Sometimes you'll experience nothing at all. But God's promise is this: Ask and you will receive. You can trust that God is with you. And it is okay to ask for a more tangible experience. I think God enjoys answering our earnest, childlike desire for more of God. So keep asking. In a moment, we're going to do that here this morning. Say to God, I'm open to you. Please help me receive you afresh. But I'd encourage you every day this week to do that, every day this year, because we so need that embrace and that knowledge that God is with us and journeying alongside us through this life. Amen. So we're going to hold just a little bit of quiet and pray for that. And then the band are going to begin to play that wonderful Taizé chant, Lord, hear my prayer. We know that God hears. How extraordinary. Let's use this time to, in our own way, show that God, tell God that we are open to receiving more of God's presence with us. If that looks for you like holding out your hands as a gesture of openness, please do that. If it looks like kneeling, please do that. God sees our hearts. So let's pray. Come, Holy Spirit. Lord, thank you for your great love for us. Lord God, thank you that you want to embrace us, to come alongside us as comforter, as friend, as intercessor. Lord, of all the things we've talked about this morning, Lord, help us to open our hearts to receive you.
last days it will be, God declares, that I will pour out my Spirit upon all people. Amen. Come, Holy Spirit. Of those who have died this year. Lord God, we pray that you would form us as a church into a people of compassion. Give us the gift of bringing hope and light. Out, Lord, to the people around us, those who don't know you, those who have no idea of what the Holy Spirit is, Lord, to minister your life and your grace. Show us where to go and how to speak. Spirit.
You sense the peace of God in that time. Please continue to pray for the gift, the baptism of the Holy Spirit this week. We come now to share that peace with one another. And perhaps we should stand and do that, shall we? Then we'll be able to turn around and wave at one another and get our blood moving. Our Saviour Christ is the Prince of Peace. Of the increase of his government and peace, there shall be no end. The peace of the Lord be always with you.
And also with you. Let us offer one another a safe sign of peace.
Peace be with you. Peace be with you. Peace be with you. Peace be with you at home. Hope you've had a nice wave from everyone. Please be seated. When we come to receive communion today, Luke and I will come to the front row, but then if everyone else could gradually come forward as you're ready. I know it's a bit awkward coming forward wearing your mask, so you might just want to receive the bread and then go back to your seat to consume that, or whatever works best for you. So let's pray at the preparation of the table. Open the heavens, Holy Spirit, for us to see Jesus interceding for us. May we be willing to share his baptism, ready to share his cup, and strengthened to serve him forever. Amen. So the Lord is here and in each household. His Spirit is with us. Lift up your hearts. We lift them to the Lord. Let us give thanks to the Lord our God. It is right to give thanks and praise. And now we give you thanks because by water and the Holy Spirit, you have made us a holy people in Jesus Christ our Lord. You renew that mystery in bread and wine to show forth your glory in all the world. In love, you gave us Jesus, your Son, to rescue us from sin and death. Your word goes out to call us home to the city where angels sing your praise, and we join with them in heaven's song, saying, Holy, holy, holy Lord, God of power and might, heaven and earth are full of your glory. Hosanna in the highest. Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. Hosanna in the highest. Father of all, we give you thanks for every gift that comes from heaven. To the darkness, Jesus came as your light. With signs of faith and words of hope, he touched untouchables with love and washed the guilty clean. This is his story. This is our song. Hosanna in the highest. The crowds came out to see your son, yet at the end they turned on him. On the night he was betrayed, he came to table with his friends to celebrate the freedom of your people. This is his story, and this is our song. Hosanna in the highest. Jesus blessed you, Father, for the food. He took bread, gave thanks, broke it, and said, "This is my body, which is given for you all." Jesus then gave thanks for the wine. He took the cup, gave it, and said, "This is my blood, shed for you all for the forgiveness of sins. Do this in remembrance of me." This is our story. This is our song. Hosanna in the highest. Therefore, Father, with this bread and this cup, we celebrate the cross on which he died to set us free. Defying death, he rose again and is alive with you to plead for us and the whole world. This is our story. This is our song. Hosanna in the highest. Send your spirit on us now, that by these gifts we may feed on Christ with opened eyes and hearts on fire. May we and all who share this physical and spiritual food offer ourselves to live for you, and so be welcomed at your feast in heaven, where all creation worships you, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. Blessing and honor and glory and power be yours forever and ever. Amen. As Jesus taught us, so we pray. Our Father in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come, your will be done, on earth as in heaven. Give us today our daily bread. Forgive us our sins, as we forgive those who sin against us. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For the kingdom, the power, and the glory are yours, now and forever. Amen. Jesus, Lamb of God, have mercy on us. Jesus, bearer of our sins, have mercy on us. Jesus, Redeemer of the world, grant us peace. I encourage you to sing in worship as we receive communion. And if you don't want to receive the bread and wine, then if you come like that, so we'd love to bless you. And we have gluten-free wafers and non-alcoholic wine as well.
Is the Truth and help us believe. Show us.
This is the body of Christ, which is given for us. Blood of Christ, keep us in eternal life. Let us pray. Eternal God and Father, whose Son at supper prayed that his disciples might be one, as he is one with you, draw us closer to him, that in common love and obedience to you, we may be united to one another in the fellowship of the one Spirit, that the world may believe that he is Lord, to your eternal glory. Through Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen. Let's stand and sing our final hymn.
I hear the rolling thunder, thy power.
great thou art. Oh, and you live in us. How extraordinary. Thank you, Lord. Well, final blessing. May God, who in Christ gives us a spring of water welling up to eternal life, perfect in you the image of his glory, and the blessing of God Almighty, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit be among you and remain with you always. Amen. One in heart and one in mind, and empowered by the Spirit, go in peace to love and serve the Lord. We go into the world to give God's hope, light, and love, to gather others for God's glory, and to grow more like Jesus. Amen. Amen. God bless you. Have a wonderful week ahead.